favor. We're going to have, we're going to go to the Samrat and have dinner, and there will also be other people going elsewhere to have dinner, so you...
At the Olive and the Orange.
At the...
Olive and the Orange.
And these are directions to the reception that's to be held at the House of Sam and Neil at 8:30, beginning at 8:30. Okay, I hope by now everyone's copied them down.
We can put them up after the talk.
Okay. So, now, I would like to put this transparency up. And I don't have an introduction, much of an introduction. I was thinking, what is it? It would be a pity to go to Paris without seeing the Eiffel Tower. It would be a pity to go to Athens without seeing the Acropolis. And it would be very much of a pity to come to Syracuse University and not meet Professor Benardete. So we have asked Professor Benardete to speak to us today, and he will deliver his paper on meaning, ontology, and anti-realism.
By holding up my two hands, G.E. Moore famously insisted in an address to the British Academy, I can now give a perfectly rigorous proof of the existence of things outside of both hands. One reason for rejecting that proof is to be found in the notorious denial of Peter Van Inwagen's material being. There are no hands or feet or ears or eyes, nor are there mountains or rivers, or chairs or tables, or even molecules or atoms. In fact, the only time the elementary particles of subatomic physics join together to constitute a material object proves to be in the case of living organisms. Call this Van Inwagen's eliminative vitalism. No wonder then that Moore's proof should be swept aside, for it may well be only one of the less important of several philosophic positions that must needs now be re-examined in the light of denial. In an ironic spirit, Van Inwagen invites his critics to explain why his denial should be taken to be any more shocking than that of a Copernican astronomer as regards the motion of the sun, who might yet be prepared to allow the vernacular utterances, like the sun just moved behind the elms, can be true. The difference between the two cases can be brought out as follows. Take some object A, of which Jones says it is moving. We have all learned how to construct scenarios where Smith says, also of A, it is not moving, and we allow that both to be right, relative, of course, to different frames of reference. If motion, then, is relative, existence, by contrast, pace Protagoras, we take to be absolute. And since Van Inwagen concurs with that discriminatory verdict regarding motion and existence, his appeal to the Copernican astronomer only renders his position the more mystified. Before dismissing Moore, however, I should concede at once that he may have succeeded in his proof after all. It all turns on whether the denial was properly to be understood as discrediting him when, in the course of his proof, Moore says, here is one hand and here is another. For at this point, the issue turns on the meaning of certain utterances, sentences or utterances, where metaphysics must give way to philosophy of language as we shift from the material mode of discourse to the formal one. A mix of these two modes best sums up Van Inwagen's position, for if in the material mode he argues that there are no hands, he is almost equally eager to urge in the formal mode that sentences like Bill's right hand is larger than Tom's are often used in everyday life to express true propositions, thereby affording Moore some chance to make good on his proof. Not that we can simply assume that in addressing the British Academy, Moore succeeded in expressing the sort of proposition that here is one hand characteristically expresses in real life. Although Moore's context of utterance militates against success in this regard, we know that Moore did try to use the sentence on uncompromisingly vernacular lines, and we might accordingly hesitate to convict him of failure from the outset. Even granting, however, that Moore succeeded in formulating a true premise, there is room to doubt that he was entitled to deduce from it, quote, the existence of things outside us, if only because the denial renders the ontological import of the premise very obscure. How Van Inwagen scrupulously distinguishes the two enterprises, metaphysics and philosophy of language, even while refusing to allow the latter to contaminate the former, I take to be a salient feature of his seminal undertaking, which might even be viewed as a piece of post-analytic philosophy on the strength of that refusal. If Michael Dummett is right when he locates precisely in Frege the first occurrence of the linguistic term, one is encouraged to suppose that it is the linguistic term above all that characterizes analytic philosophy. Although material beings cannot be described as involving any outright break with the linguistic term, thanks to the fact that philosophy of language does play a role in Van Inwagen's overall position, that role is expressly shown by him to be detachable from his pure ontology of life with its attendant denial. For he declines to close the door on the suggestion that vernacular utterances, with the ostensible form there are Fs, can never achieve an aletheic status beyond that of being true enough for all practical purposes but strictly false, when the F slot is filled by such general terms as hand, mountain, or chair. We are thus invited to choose between the preferred A version of material beings and its optional B alternative. According to A, vernacular chair utterances are often true. According to B, and here I go for vividness at the expense of accuracy, they're always false. Not quite always, since the B version allows that negative vernacular utterances, like there are no chairs in the attic, can be true. Waiving, of course, the ontological status of atoms. No matter. The ontology of material beings transcends the petty linguistic considerations that divide A from B. So on a deeper reading, material beings does involve a radical break with the linguistic term. And one might then expect it to be especially enjoyed as an exemplary piece of post-analytic philosophy by the continentals among us, who with ill-concealed impatience regard the analytic movement as a guest that has long outstayed its welcome. Much as I might like to climb aboard that bandwagon, I fear that the linguistic turn has bequeathed us a lot of unfinished business that material being succeeds only in exacerbating. A deeply disturbing, even disorienting book, it was while still in manuscript form that it launched a series of discussions here at Syracuse that have persisted without interruption present day. Two principal phases can be distinguished, an early realist one featuring Mark Heller and Michael Patton, followed by a more recent anti-realist phase largely associated with John O'Leary Hawthorne, Andrew Cortens, and Philip Goggins, though it should be added that the realist line of discussion continues even today, notably in Eric Olson. How this issue of realism and anti-realism arises in connection with the denial can be brought out by considering it in conjunction with another recent, albeit much less radical, denial, namely that of C.L. Hardin in his Color for Philosophers, when he writes the physical objects are not colored. Although this statement has ostensibly rather to do with Quine's idiom, ideology, than with ontology, that deficiency is remedied later in the sentence by the words, "We have no good reason to believe that there are colored objects." So in canonical notation, Hardin may be presumed to be subscribing to one in his ontology that does not exist in X. X is a colored physical object. Our worries begin when we find Hardin also prepared to write, "Common descriptions of colored objects are, for common purposes, correct enough," which might perhaps be taken at great risk to warrant the assumption two, there exists an X, X is a colored object. How then to avoid contradicting oneself here? Well, I'm sure there is no need to panic. The easiest way out is simply to reject two as being at all adequate when it comes to expressing what it is for a description of color to be correct or not for common purposes. If material beings allows for a B as well as an A reading, the same option goes for color for philosophers as well, and to an even greater extent, since the ontological status of the so-called secondary qualities was a vexed issue even in antiquity. As a test case then, let us formulate an ontological thesis, namely three. which Hardin and Van Inwagen will jointly endorse, though perhaps for very different reasons, seeing that the former draws heavily on the facts of physics, while the latter's position is more purely a prioristic in character. There does not exist an X, X is a chair, and X is blue. As to whether three conflicts with anything asserted by the man in the street, most of us are probably of two minds, with some of us being pulled largely in one direction and others in the other. Nor is it the case that our putative man in the street is someone whom we can only observe from outside, like some alien in Gavagai country. Each of us is that man in the street, as each of us is also a metaphysician, if only pro tem, puzzled about Hardin and Van Inwagen's assertion of three. So there are two language games in which we participate by turns, the vernacular one of everyday English, and the jargon-ridden one of philosophy, where the latter can be identified more narrowly with the Quine project of ontological commitment, which John Searles pejoratively styled as the ontology game. Adept in both language games as a bilingual, each of us is challenged to draw on our, quote, insider's knowledge of what expressions in each language mean, recalling William P. Alston's critique of Quine's thesis regarding indeterminacy of radical translation, in order to determine whether three, taken from within the ontologies of Hardin and Van Inwagen, conflicts with four, taken on some particular occasion of everyday use. Four, there is a blue chair in the attic. And now I am prompted to emulate Alston in his eloquent protest against Quine on radical translation, when on the same page, he formulated the following rhetorical question. How can it be maintained that A knows both what Gavagai means and what rabbit means, but can't determine whether they are at least approximately the same in meaning? For much the same sort of protest might be brought mutatis mutandis in regard to four and three star, where three star is just three after the negation sign has been lopped off. It might even be supposed that my own protest has greater warrant than Alston's, for in my case, the issue of radical translation simply does not arise. If four is to be viewed as embedded in everyday English, three and three star can be said to operate merely within a technical dialect of it, thereby supplying us with good prospects for translating back and forth between the two. How then explain the fact that when Van Inwagen expresses his belief that the metaphysical assertion of three is logically compatible with any vernacular assertion of four, he makes no appeal to, quote, his insider's knowledge of what expressions in each language mean. To the contrary, he relies here entirely on his philosophy of language, a move that is in no way idiosyncratic, like his denial. Nor is there anything unexpected in his plumping for the A version over the B, for that is precisely what standard philosophy of language today would urge. Radical in his ontology, Van Inwagen is probably to be taken as fairly mainstream in his philosophy of language, though it is not as if our worries could be allayed simply by switching from the A to the B version of material beings. What exactly are those worries, and how are they involved in the interplay between metaphysics and philosophy of language? Well, suppose we agree that anything like introspection, the scare quotes indicate our impatience with Cartesian mentalism, is of little value when it comes to determining whether three and four are logically compatible. Plunged into a fog, we attempt to assert five. But we don't know what we mean when we engage in vernacular utterances like four. Tempted, I'd say, because philosophy of language today regards five as utterly taboo, and I'm not brave enough to transgress it. In the present context of discussion, however, we may well be entitled to use five to express what will be acknowledged to be a true proposition. So five then can be said to be contextually true without being true simplicative. In the same vein, we may suspect that though Hardin and Van Inwagen do succeed in expressing a true proposition, a different proposition perhaps in the two cases, in their use of three, we may have a right to demand of them a paraphrase of three that does not even appear in its surface form to contradict vernacular utterances of four. The tables are turned. Why not insist on a paraphrase of three instead of four? Taking our bearings by the vernacular use of the existential quantifier, we are asking Hardin and Van Inwagen to formulate their true proposition in such a way that it is free of any suggestion to the effect that, reverting to the vernacular, there are no blue chairs. If the whole issue turns now on the propriety of the metaphysicians using certain ordinary words like exist, as in blue chairs don't exist, or they're on. It is not as if our qualms were quite without precedent in the philosophical literature. Quine himself can be found to gloss his famous criterion of ontological commitment in terms of a refined sense of existence, that's a quotation from Quine, thereby inviting someone to respond to Holland and Van Inwagen, the crude sense of existence is good enough for me. Let it be granted that blue chairs fail to exist in your refined sense of exist. It is enough that they exist in the crude sense of the word. Reminiscent of the ordinary language philosophy of the 50s, this response is designed to express a hearty confidence in blue chairs, harking back at least to Moore, if not to Dr. Johnson, when he undertook his own crude refutation of Berkeley by kicking a stone. Lest it be supposed that long before Quine, a refined sense of existence was already well entrenched in the standard jargon of philosophy, even certain post-Quinean remarks of Jonathan Bennett can give one a distinct pause in that regard. I refer in particular to his extended study of events, where, though our event concept proves serviceable enough in the, quote, hurly-burly of everyday thought and speech, end quote, by affording us, quote, rather small and indeterminate gobbets of information, end quote, it turns out that, quote, the particular way in which events are supervenient, end quote, on subatomic physical reality, quote, unfits our event concept for serious theoretical use, end quote. So Bennett then declines to quantify over events in his ontology, so we might surmise, particularly since he is persuaded that, quote, the persistent disagreements among philosophers about the nature of events, their role in causal statements, their identity conditions, their relations to space-time, etc., have arisen partly from the fact that some of the disputed questions have no answers, end quote. Even in the face of all these strong considerations militating against the inclusion of events in his ontology, Bennett shrinks from taking the final step, though not without reproaching himself in the process. Stop shilly-shallying, he writes. Are there such things as events or aren't there? Forced to come to the replies with breathtaking simplicity. Well, there was an earthquake in California last week, so there are events. And quote, can it really be so simple? Although Bennett's enthymematic argument can be seen to be formally valid once we supply the following unexceptionable missing premise for every X is an earthquake, implies X is an event. Anyone caught up in Quine's project of ontological commitment is bound to protest as follows. By parity of reasoning, one might as well argue that the shape of this vase is the same as the shape of that one. Therefore, there are abstract entities. Or closer to home, why not just say that there's a blue chair in the attic? Therefore, Harden and Van Inwagen are mistaken in their respective denials. The shape argument is especially on target owing to the fact that it is precisely the traditional issue of nominalism versus Platonism that supplies Quine with his paradigm of ontological commitment. A Platonist himself, Quine is by no means bowled over by the shape argument, seeing that it relies solely on the locutions of everyday life. Let a nominalist succeed in purging the natural sciences of all ostensible reference to abstract entities, and Quine will not hesitate to revert to his early nominalism. A closer look at Bennett shows that his case for events is a bit more complex than I've let on. Suppose that, quote, we can extract absurdities or contradictions, end quote, from their regard. Then we might well choose to be, quote, like those who were led by the puzzle about the ship of Theseus, to refuse to admit shoes and ships, etc., into their strict inventory of the world's contents, end quote. And we might express ourselves plausibly enough by saying, quote, strictly speaking, there are no events. Even in this counterfactual situation, however, for nothing like the ship of Theseus can Bennett find to be infecting events, I have the distinct impression that he regards the strictly speaking locution to be merely optional and by no means mandatory, very much as if he shared my uneasiness regarding Quine's refined sense of existence. The uneasiness arises in the first instance over a seemingly picayune point concerning use in mentra. Speaking of a refined sense of existence, Quine must surely mean a refined sense of, quotes now, existence, end quote. That is, the word existence. For though there can be more than one sense of the word existence, or the word knowledge, or the word bank, how could knowledge itself, the very thing, whatever it might be, have just one, or just two, or just three senses? Only words have sense, or senses, in the relevant sense of the word sense. Ostensibly using the word existence when he invokes a, ostensibly using the word existence when he invokes a refined sense of existence, Quine must be merely mentioning it. Convicting Quine of confusing use of mention is rather like a proposal to excommunicate the Pope. Something has gone amiss, and it's not hard to pin it down. An outright recognition of a refined as well as crude sense of the word existence would land Quine back in the realm of meaning and synonymy from which he exited with the beating of drums a decade earlier, two dogmas of empiricism, hence the waffling. Restoring the peccant phrase to the whole disturbing paragraph from which it was torn will serve to confirm the central thesis of my paper, namely, that the rejection of blue chairs by Harden and Van Inwagen ought not to be taken by us merely at face value as a metaphysical thesis, which we are free to endorse or dismiss on its merits, but the philosophy of language considerations need to be brought antecedently to bear upon it. Not that the latter project precludes the former. Specifically in regard to material beings, David Johnson's internal critique of the denial I have found to be especially probative. Leading into our paragraph, Quine has just written that philosophy as an effort to get clearer on things is not to be distinguished in essential points of purpose and method from good and bad science. He now continues. In particular, we shall find, as we get on with organizing and adjusting various of the turns of phrase that participate in what tasks for affirmations of existence, that certain of these take on key significance in the increasingly systematic structure. And then reacting in a manner typical of scientific behavior, we shall come to favor these idioms as the existence affirmations, quote, strictly so-called, end quote. One could even end up, though we ourselves shall not, by finding that the smoothest, most adequate overall account of the world does not, after all, accord existence to ordinary physical things in that refined sense of existence. On the previous page, Quine writes, it was a lexicographer, Dr. Johnson, who demonstrated the reality of a stone by kicking it, where the word reality answers to his remark that there is a certain verbal perversity in the idea that familiar physical things are not real, seeing that the word real was too ill-defined to stand up under such punishment. Though, quote, such eventual departures from Johnsonian usage could partake of the spirit of science and even of the evolutionary spirit of ordinary language itself. Sheer bravado, early readers of Word and Object were prone to exclaim in response to this at the time, weird suggestion that we might end up refusing to accord existence to ordinary physical things. What could such a denial possibly consist in? For one rightly presumed that the only option readily thinkable in 1960, namely a return to idealism, Quine would ruthlessly dismiss. In the hindsight of 30 years of the material beings available to us, Quine's suggestion takes on the character of serendipity, for we now know exactly how to proceed, wielding Occam's razor, quantifying only over the elementary particles of physics. Yes, one's own existence, being that of an animal, does appear to pose an insurmountable hurdle to any such radicalization of eliminative materialism, which eliminates mountains and persons alike at one blow. It is precisely this consideration that underlies Van Inwagen's vitalism. But we need to ask whether extending this denial, call this the augmented denial, the human beings in particular and organisms in general, places one outside the bounds of sober rationality. Quixotic, sir, and even somewhat zany, Michael Patton was felt to be when he defended the augmented denial in his doctoral dissertation to a chorus of titters and giggles on the part of his examiners. Such merriment, I can still recall. The proper response to which I take to go as follows. When Van Inwagen denies that there are chairs, that, of course, is very radical. But as for me, I am content to be hanged for a sheep as for a lamb, in a more technical vein. The issue turns on the status of six, taken to be a vernacular utterance. Six. There are seven people in the room, but only six chairs. Granting for the nonce that six fails to entail the metaphysical existence of chairs, does it at least entail that there are people in Quine's refined sense of existence? Although Van Inwagen in his A version probably answers this question in the affirmative, to the degree that material beings may be said to allow a B as well as an A reading, we are advised now to split the A version into two subversions, A1 and A2. According to A1, people and chairs figure equally in six, no metaphysical favoritism being chosen toward the former as over against the latter. By contrast, A2 insists that six involves an ontological commitment to people, but not to chairs. as between A1 and A2, I think that formal and systematic considerations, looking no further, do tend to support the no favoritism approach of A1, and what is thereby provided with a convenient bridge to the augmented denial, particularly if, and I owe this point to Eric Olson, one's confidence in so-called folk psychological explanations of human behavior in terms of beliefs and desires has already been at least somewhat undermined by recent discussion. In any event, the augmented denial, by taking its bearings by 7, claims that its metaphysical rejection of people and chairs alike is fairly benign. 7, there was a severe sugar shortage in Moscow this winter. Anyone playing the ontology game today will take sugar shortage to be just the sort of thing over which one declines to quantify in one's ontology. Mixing the material and formal modes rather differently from my earlier use of them, the augmented denial can now be expressed as follows. Of course there are people in chains, speaking in the vernacular, just as there are sugar shortages and earthquakes, pace bene. But Occam's razor alone mandates that only the elementary particles of physics, throw-in sets of abstract entities are required, ought to be quantified over in any properly austere ontology. Notice that this doctrine of mereological nihilism, so-called because it denies that anything is a part of anything, may well concede that there are good reasons, though there are here fails to carry any ontological commitments to reasons, for quantifying over persons, oneself above all, and others on the strength of that. Good reasons, yes, but not compelling ones, which precisely what ontology in the Occamite tradition with its taste for desert landscapes demands. If we can now vividly understand how Quine could, quote, end up by finding that the smoothest and most adequate overall account of the world does not accord existence to ordinary physical objects and that refined sense of existence, end quote, there is always the retort, so much the worse for your refined sense of existence, who needs it? Very much in that vein, Daniel Dennett, in his final summing up of his position on consciousness in general, and Quasar in particular, can write, are pains real? They're as real as haircuts, and dollars, and opportunities, and persons, and centers of gravity. But how real is that? And he crassly adds in High Fettle, do you really need something to print on your t-shirt? Is Dennett then an anti-realist about persons, seeing that he knows the Quintian ontology will almost certainly refrain from quantifying over opportunities, not to mention the other oddities in his list? Or is he rather be taken as reenacting the kind of misgivings about Quine's criterion of ontological commitment that William P. Alston implicitly expressed more than 3 decades ago? Turning the clock back to the problematic transition from the age of Wittgenstein to that of Quine, which is only now receding from view, proves to be imperative if the challenge posed by material beings above all, Daniel Dennett and C.L. Hardin, not to mention Jonathan Bennett, I take to raise collateral issues, is to be addressed in any adequate fashion. Specifically, recall how the Wittgensteinians of the 50s undertook to defuse skepticism, and you'll have a convenient model at hand for understanding Bennett Wagner's denial. The skeptic also has his denial. He denies that we can know that there are chairs or mountains or hammocks, and so far Bennett Wagner agrees with him, albeit for deviant reasons of his own. What needs to be noticed now is that skepticism admits of a dual reading consisting of an A as well as a B version, quite on a par with that of material being. Smith says to Jones, do you know if there's any beer in the fridge? And Jones replies, yes, there is beer in the fridge. And yes, also, I know that to be the case. Is the proposition asserted by Jones logically compatible with that upon which the skeptic insists? Surely not, is one's first form, the B version. But nowhere is the Wittgensteinian revolution more compelling than in the theory of meaning that renders it highly implausible that Jones could be at odds with skepticism. Jones and the skeptic may be presumed to be talking across purposes, for it is easy enough to assign a true proposition to the skeptic that will leave Jones's assertion unimpaired, the A version. The skeptic asserts that Jones cannot be absolutely certain of there being beer in the fridge, and most epistemologists today agree with that, even while insisting both that A, what Jones said is true, and a stronger, that is, more vulnerable claim in my view, that B, Jones does know there to be beer in the fridge. The Wittgensteinians thus convicted the skeptic of committing the Pickwickian fallacy by investing the ordinary word no with a superset, requiring absolute certainty, even while trading illicitly on the vulgar sense. So So in the Oxonian idiom, Jones fails to know that there is beer in the fridge only in a Pickwickian sense of the word no. If a lot has happened in epistemology since the 50s, I believe that this remains even today the key move in the discipline. And though there are various refinements that have emerged in the interim, Montella mentioned one a few weeks ago, to which I shall return, nothing has fundamentally changed, as Wittgenstein is almost certainly to be credited with the modern breakthrough in epistemology. By parity of reasoning, it is easy now to see how the Quinean project of ontological commitment, with its express reliance on a refined sense of existence, might also be charged with a Pickwickian fallacy. Though it was not until the denial of material beings that the issue, anticipated by Alston and Searle, could probably come to a head. Almost immediately after his disturbing paragraph, Quine resumes as follows. Our words continue to make passable sense because of continuity of change of theory. End quote. And I'm here interested only in those vernacular, quote, turns of phrase that participate in what pass for affirmations of existence, end quote, such as there was a sugar shortage in Moscow this winter. Quine now adds in the same vein, we warp usage gradually enough to avoid rupture, gradually enough, even if we choose at a blow to follow Van Inwagen's in his denials, thereby refusing to, quote, accord existence of ordinary physical things, end quote. Living organisms alone accepted, though even these may go if we plunge all the way with Michael Patton into meriological nihilism. Very little that is gradual about that. If it is precisely such a rupture that especially invites the Pickwickian charge, Quine's own practice over the years has been indeed very gradualist, which probably explains why the misgivings of Alston and Searle could come to seem hardly more than grumbling, particularly since the historical abandonment of Wittgenstein for Quine can be shown to have occurred for very good reasons. By no means the first to reopen the Wittgensteinian problematic after a generation of neglect, I take the challenge of material beings to provide a scarcely resistible incentive to subject the ontology game once again to a philosophy of language and critique, which is not to say that I am engaged in rehashing the Alston Searle critique of a generation ago, for that critique never really came to grips with Quine's program. Notice in particular how after canvassing various, quote, confusions infecting it, Searle fixes on, quote, a more profound confusion, end quote, felt by him to be, quote, underlying them. Namely, quote, to suppose that talk of universals is somehow puzzling or unwelcome or metaphysical. But to say the property of saintliness is something none of us possess is just a fancy way of saying none of us are saints. Hence, the harmlessness of the first way of saying it. End of quotation from Searle. Of course, this is only an example that Searle must suppose to have more general application. Consider then 8, where such properties as the property of being circular or rectangular come into play. 8. Some shapes, that is, shape properties, are uninstantiated. Is 8 also harmless? Well, yes, if it can be shown to be just a fancy way of saying, so fill in the blank, yielding a plain statement. One of our ablest philosophers, Roderick Chisholm, having undertaken to do just that, confessed his failure in the enterprise, whereupon he declared himself a Platonist. So 8 really is harmful, and Searle would advise Chisholm to eschew it. Even though Chisholm takes 8 to be probably true, a clue that something is fishy, that's a quote from Searle, in the ontology game, Searle finds in the nominalist injunction to eschew, Searle's word, universal. Again, quote, I can countenance or refuse to countenance rude behavior by my children, but how do I go about countenancing numbers or classes, end quote. Well, Searle has shown us precisely how, when he insists that talk about the property of saintliness is just a fancy way of saying something that on the face of it is acceptable to the nominalist. Denying that proposition is how one goes about countenancing the property of saintliness in the ontology game. Ontology aside, the whole issue can be found to originate in simple exercises in school logic. Here is one. Is the following argument valid? For every X, X is one of us, implies it is not the case that X is a saint. Therefore, there exists a Y such that for every X, X is one of us, implies it's not the case that X possesses Y. Granted that being cast in semi-formal terms, the argument falls betwixt and between a fully formalized version and one that is entirely vernacular, the logician will not look kindly at the suggestion that is at least implicitly valid, particularly if one appeals to the fancy paraphrase of the premise in order to eke it out. How fancy ways of talking can prove harmful in logic, the case at hand can only confirm. And it is thus that the rationale of Quine's return to ontology, quote, from a logical point of view, grows increasingly evident. At the same time, one may be brought to understand in a flash why the denial of material beings can appear so radically shocking in the contemporary context. But perhaps another example, this one from Alston's paper, may prove still more helpful. Now, there is a possibility that James will come. One of the Quinians, Morton Quine, had asked how we can clarify that puzzling sentence, quote, and yet avoid the unwelcome conclusion that there are possibilities, end quote. Quine's solution proceeded by showing, quote, how the belief of the ordinary man was expressed by noun can be read, quote, rendered in language that is not misleading, namely by ten. The statement that James will come is not certainly false. Thereby, quote, what we have done is to show that we need not assert the existence of possibilities in communicating what we want to communicate, end quote. In reply to which, Alston trenchantly argued as follows. Now, it is puzzling to me that anyone should claim that these translations, there were others on exhibit, show that we need not assert the existence of possibility in communicating what we want to communicate. For if the translation, my numbering henceforth, of 9 into 10, for example, is adequate, then they are normally used to make the same assertion. In uttering 10, we would be making the same assertion as we would make if we uttered 9. That is the assertion that there is a possibility that James will come. And so we would be asserting that there is a possibility, committing ourselves to the existence of a possibility, just as much by using 10 as by 9. If, on the other hand, the translation is not adequate, it has not been shown that we can, by uttering 10, communicate what we wanted to communicate when we uttered 9. Hence, the point of the translation cannot be put in terms of some assertion or commitment from which it saves us. End quote. Simply in the way of a school exercise in logic, did Alston at the time regard the following argument as valid? 9, therefore 11. Where 11 is, there exists an X. X is a possibility. Not that there is any special cachet attached to the backward E as it figures in 11. In my own case, at any rate, the existential quantifier in 11 alerted me to a difficulty that I would probably have overlooked in its absence. Suppose I make an assertion using 9. Am I then saying that there is at least one possibility that James will come, but maybe 2 or 3 or 4,986? Although I distrust introspection in these matters of meaning, I can only report that nothing of the sort seems to me to be going on. No number of possibilities seems to be at all relevant. Which is not to deny that in the recent wake of our elaborate possible world semantics removal logic, a strong case can be made for quantifying over possibilities in our ontology. No matter. Turning the clock back to 1958, we are asked to rule on the validity or invalidity of the argument 9, therefore 11, in a fairly isolated manner, though the argument 7, therefore 12, can doubtless be taken in conjunction with it. 12, there exists an X. X is a sugar shortage. For again, we can ask whether there is precisely one sugar shortage in Moscow this winter or 43. So there may be something fishy going on in 7 as well as 9, if only because at a pinch one could probably argue, inconclusively of course, that to each Muscovite whose supply of sugar was severely curtailed, a distinct sugar shortage had obtained. But let us stick to 9 and pretend that my casual remarks querying it can be systematically developed into a decisive argument to the effect that 9 fails to entail that there is at least one possibility. How slender are the prospects of any such outcome can be seen in the recent fate of Bertrand Russell's classic paper on denoting, which doubtless provides the original model for my own exercise in what Russell called logical analysis. At one time it claims as a decisive refutation of my novel. The paper has recently given rise to serious attempts at rebuttal designed to rehabilitate his position. Anyway, pretense is quite enough for us in conjunction with 9, which is merely serving as a foil for the blue chair of 4. The whole point of my exercise has been to show that though 9 and 4 might be allowed to have the same surface ground, at any rate relative to our purposes, they might well turn out to differ in their underlying logical form, where the rationale for using the word logical here springs from the role of logical entailment. discussion. In particular, we understand how nine, taken as a true vernacular utterance, might really seem to entail that there is at least one possibility without really doing so. Notice, moreover, that I can say this without having recourse to Quine's refined sense of existence, though his disturbing paragraph on page 4 of Hidden Object, a paragraph that in retrospect we can only view as contaminated by the ordinary language vogue of the 50s, can otherwise be put to work for us. For the suggestion comes to this. Although the two tokens of the string of words there is an F that launch 9 and 4 respectively, count as, quote, turns of phrase that participate in what pass for affirmations of existence, end quote, they may not be in the decisive respect on an ontological pole at all. And that difference will in fact obtain if 4 entails that there is at least one chair, while 9 fails to entail that there is at least one possibility. No wonder then that in these circumstances, the vernacular string there is AF or an F, as it figures in 4, will, quote, take on key significance in the increasingly systematic structure, end quote, projected by our canonical notation. And it will then be cases of this sort, as opposed to cases like 9, that in altogether unproblematic fashion, quote, we shall come to favor as the existence affirmations strictly support. Suppose now that with this framework in place, it is suggested that vernacular utterances of 4 could in turn be true, even though there's not a single blue chip. Well, we could only stare at the bewilderment at any such proposal. If the surface grammar of 4 also belies its underlying logical form, where in the vernacular is the existential quantifier to be found operative both as the logical form and surface grammar? The most obvious suggestion consonant with material beings would have us favor 13 as our touchstone of existence. 13, there's a brown cow in the barn. On this suggestion, 13 and 4 merely seem to have the same logical form, namely their existent X, FX. But in fact, grasping the truth conditions of 13 must involve a very different process of understanding from that required by 4, and one would then expect the difference to show up even in a homophonic Davidsonian theory of meaning, for example, featuring Tarskian T sentences at its core. If all that strikes me as implausible in the extreme, that may be largely owing to the fact that no one has yet undertaken to implement this semantic project. Much more promising, however, I take to be some recent remarks of Mark Heller that lend themselves to a defense of the skeptic against the Wittgensteinian charge of committing the Wittgensteinian fallacy. For it is that same charge that constitutes my principal worry concerning the denial of material beings. And if this one charge can be met, why not the other? The appeal here is to the relevant alternatives epistemology of Fred Dredsky. Knowing that P on this account consists above all in ruling out the relevant alternatives to P, as determined by the pragmatic parameters of the occasion. So when Jones says that he knows there to be beer in the fridge, what he says is true relative to the pragmatic constraints of the occasion as determined by Smith's query, but not relative to the concerns of the Descartes vexed by the prospect of being deceived by the evil genius. Wittgenstein himself, I take to have pretty much anticipated this ironic approach 11 days before his death in April 1951, witness sections 553 and 554 of Uncertainty. It is queer if I say, without any special occasion, I know. For example, I know that I'm now sitting in a chair. This statement seems to be unjustified and presumptuous. But if I make the same statement where there is some need for it, then although I'm not a jot more certain of its truth, it seems to me to be perfectly justified and every day. In its language game, it is not presumptuous. There, it has no higher position than simply the human language game. For there, it has its restricted application. But as soon as I say this sentence outside its context, it appears in a false light. So then it is as if I wanted to insist that there are things that I know. God himself can't say anything to me about them. If the operative, operative words in this discussion can be seen to be a restricted application outside its context, what are the prospects of adapting this flexible, context-sensitive approach to the metaphysical denial of material beings? One has at least a model at hand to emulate in undertaking to formulate a rebuttal to the charge of committing the Pickwickian fallacy. A model all the more attractive thanks to Wittgenstein's coming to welcome it as regards the epistemological denial of the skeptic. Here again, however, my prognosis is far from sanguine. Already in section 6, Wittgenstein writes, now, can one enumerate what one knows, like Moore? Straight off like that, I believe not, end quote. Nor, I would add, could a list be made by me or even by God of what someone else knows, if indeed logic knowledge claims are inherently infected with context relativity. Hence, an in-principle difference emerges as between the epistemological and the metaphysical case. For Protagoras aside, one does suppose that a list could be made of what there is, even if no one could know how to tell the one true list from the many false ones. Let me simply assume that a satisfactory response to the Pickwickian challenge might well be available, perhaps even related to gestures of my own in that direction. There is quite another challenge, however, that arises precisely in connection with that putative list, and here also I propose to turn back the clock to the year 1950, when Rudolf Carnap drew his once famous distinction between internal and external questions in his paper, Empiricism, Semantics, and Ontology, in the Revue Internationale de Philosophie. Overall, I am thus to be seen as being engaged in a conceptual archaeology of the recent past, now that the disorientating denial of material beings has forced us to recognize how top-heavy analytical philosophy has become, with its rich deposit of successive strata going back to Frege. Despite even the best efforts of Jonathan Bennett, analytical philosophy remains prone to despise history of philosophy, and there is a special irony in the fact that in the wake of material beings above all, analytical philosophy is being forced to backtrack in order to confront its own history anew. Although one could start at either end, with Carnap or Van Inwagen, it is by playing both ends against the middle of the dialectic would be found to proceed most effectively. In the reckless spirit of one might as well be hanged for a sheep as for a lamb, we have already followed Michael Patton in radicalizing the argument of material beings. But why stop with Patton's myriological nihilism, as if one had finally hit rock bottom? Doubtless influenced in part by the thought that ontological commitment in the Quinean vein may require a language shift toward a refined sense of existence, we are quite prepared to reinvoke Occam's razor virtually across the board, leaving in our ontology only a single object, namely the space-time continuum itself, being further encouraged by Jonathan Bennett, who has construed Spinoza's substance monism along these post-Einsteinian lines. Recalling Plato's Timaeus as well, space-time would then be said to be fiery here and watery there, and even quarkish elsewhere, or in Van Inwagen's idiom, it would be chairish here and mountainous over there. If mountains are thus to be viewed in Spinoza's jargon as mere modes of substance, any suggestion that we might be quantifying of the modes has already been eliminated by Bennett's adjectival approach. Aptly characterized by Nelson Goodman as ways of world-making, these rival ontologies of meriological nihilism and post-Einsteinian Spinozism, not to mention others, may well be felt to be too factitious to have any chance of being true in some mind-independent fashion. And when one may then have recourse to recent jargon by way of urging that there's no fact of the matter as to whether quarks or mountains or people do exist. Alternatively, one may choose to say that mountains do exist relative to this or that ontology or conceptual scheme, though they fail to exist relative to others where, of course, only empirically adequate ontologies are at all relevant. But such locutions on the face of it entail that there is, at any rate, one sort of object that does exist, absolutely speaking, namely those very conceptual schemes relative to which everything else exists or fails to exist. That these anti-realist intuitions prove to be finally incoherent, I thus take to be a serious possibility. And it is at this point that Carnap's twofold distinction between A, the material and formal modes of discourse, and B, internal and external questions may offer a way out. If one remains informally prepared to express one's anti-realist intuitions in the material mode, any austere formulation of the position will then be cast in the formal mode, in the hope that coherence will be achieved on that level. The question whether there are quarks, choosing a case almost at random, may of course figure twice over, once as an internal question and again as an external one. Tomorrow physicists may decide that there are no quarks at all. That would resolve an internal question. But even if quarks are here to stay in standard physics, the neo-spinicist will refuse to quantify over them in his austerely monistic ontology. That then would count as an external, ergo metaphysical resolution of the issue, regarding which Carnap insisted there was no fact of the matter, anachronistically invoke the uncurrent idiom as to where the truth lies. So here also there proved to be two senses, or at any rate two uses of the existential quantifier, one internal and factual, the other external and pejoratively metaphysical, that would have to be accommodated by any adequate theory of meaning. unseasonably recalling Carnap's late day, is bound to invite the following line of protest. But surely Carnap's proposal was discredited in the 50s and 60s by the Quinean juggernaut, which still more formally demolished Wittgenstein's approach along with it. Well, yes, to both claims. But specifically as regards Carnap, it was an extraneous fact that the prematurely shunted his suggestion to the sidelines. In 1950, it was still possible to believe that material object statements could be reductively translated into the idiom of sense data. And it was thus this possibility that provided Carnap with an attractive model of rival ontologies covering the same empirical facts. With the abandonment of that project of translation, Carnap's proposal reverted to being no more than an abstract schema that could only languish in the absence of any proper content to apply to it. Three or four decades later, it may now be feasible to reopen the issue. And if that is, at any rate, one option to pursue, there is another, taking us all the way back to Frege himself. It is prompted by an inspired remark of John Searle that arises in a recent controversy of his with Peter Van Inwagen. Although Searle credited his approach to Alston, there are some reasons to believe that in recent years Alston has relinquished it. In his 1958 paper addressed, Alston addressed 14 and 15 in my numbering, as well as 9 and 10, 14. There is a meaning which can be given to his remarks, 15, his remarks can be understood in a certain way. With respect then to 14 and 15, along with 9 and 10, Alston remarked, quote, "It is puzzling to me that anyone should claim that these translations show that we need not assert the existence of possibilities, meanings, virtues, and facts in communicating what we want to communicate," end quote. Notice, however, that more than two decades later, in an exchange with Quine, Alston can write, "I am wholly in sympathy with Quine's repudiation of special relevant meanings," surely indicating thereby his conviction that no merely vernacular utterance of 14 commits the speaker to the existence of meanings. How even today the Alston-Searle critique of ontological commitment retains its importance comes through most clearly in connection with, quote, "an issue that Searle rightly describes as actually quite deep," writing as follows. "Thinghood is the metaphysical correlate of naming and referring. But the unit of commitment is not that of simply naming or referring. Rather, it is minimally an entire speech act. So there could not be any separate category of commitments that is especially tied to noun phrases, because the noun phrase only functions as part of the total speech act," end quote. And now for Searle's inspired comment. Perhaps this is what Frege meant when he said, "It is only in the context of a sentence that a word is meaning." Well, by his famous context principle, Frege did mean something very like what Searle was getting at. And we are thus forcibly reminded that the pairing game, not the crying game, the pairing game as played by Alston and Searle actually originates with Frege, notably in 15 and 16, as they figure in section 64 of the Grundlagen der Arithmetik of 1884. 15. The direction of A is the same as the direction of B. Line A is parallel to line B. Here, indeed, adapting Searle's words, Frege's 15 can be seen to be just a fancy way of saying what 16 says with much less ontological baggage. However, quote, "the pair with which Frege is really concerned," I'm quoting Dubbett now, "is section 64, as supplied by 17 and 18. 17, the number of Fs is the same as the number of Gs. 18, there are just as many Fs as Gs. Earlier, Dummett had identified the first occurrence of a linguistic turn in contemporary philosophy with the emergence of the context principle in Frege, and more particularly with the moment at which he, quote, puts it to work in Grundlagen with section 62, when having asked the Kantian question, how are numbers given to us, he answers it by an appeal to the context principle, which leads him into an inquiry into how it is possible to fix the sense of sentences containing numerical terms. Thereby, in one of the important turning points in the history of philosophy, Frege has thus converted an epistemological inquiry into a linguistic one," end quote, "that came to be seen as decisive in liberating philosophy from the earlier Cartesian turn into theory of knowledge." It is enough to mention Paul Benesserov's 1965 paper, "What Numbers Could Not Be," less than a century later, in order to realize how the epistemological issue could surface anew with all the insistence one expects from a return of the repressed. Still more recently, however, Crispin Wright has undertaken to reinstate numbers on the cheap by means of a strategy that one can only style as the Alston-Searle-Wright approach, though it is in fact nothing but Frege's own strategy in Grundlagen that he expressly rejected within a few pages of launching it. Recall the reason for that rejection. The possibility of James's coming, using Austin's example, where we may assume for the nonce that the definite description does succeed in denoting a single object, might, for all we know, be none other than Julius Caesar. Although the Julius Caesar problem initially strikes every reader as absurd, according to Dutton, it is the beginning of Freudian wisdom to appreciate its force, and at the very least, it can serve to prepare us for the mature Freud of the Grundgesetze der Arithmetik of 1893, who is now equipped with his post-Grundlagen distinction between the sense and reference of an expression that undergirds a new principle of Freud's, arguably as important as the context principle itself. This new principle is the principle of compositionality, in the light of which not only Searle's saintliness and Alston's possibility proved to be semantically defective, but, more striking still, the same holds for Frege's directions and numbers as those terms are introduced in Grundlagen through the context principle. One example will suffice to make the devastating point of Michael Dummett, as against Crispin Roth. Let 17 be taken as equivalent as you please to 18, even to the extent of synonymy. No such holistic equivalence can succeed in endowing the singular term, the number of Fs, as it figures in 16, with a sense, let alone a reference of its own. How then can the sense of the whole sentence be determined by the senses of its component parts, as the principle of compositionality requires? Dummett can now write, the notion of the reference of the term as determined by its sense plays no role in our conception of what determines the thought is true or false, nor, therefore, in our grasping the thought. The attribution of reference to the term may be defensible when tolerantly viewed, but is semantically idle, end quote. Reference here, of course, can only be conceded on a long anti-realist line. The relevance of the discussion of material beings should be fairly obvious. Take the sentence, that is Venus, as used by an astronomer pointing to the heavens. If the A version will allow that the astronomer has expressed a true proposition by means of it, that holistic verdict leaves open the compositional role of the proper name in determining it. What will the A reading say about the proposition expressed by a linguist when he remarks, although the proper name Pegasus fails to denote anything, Venus does succeed in denoting something? Well, I should suppose that again, a true proposition will be conceded to have been brought into play. Is there a metaphysical use of that sentence, which issues in a false proposition? For if there are no planets, as material beings insist, presumably the expression Venus fails to denote anything. Frege, of course, would be utterly baffled by any such suggestion, reminding us of the close association of ontology with theory of meaning and the analytic tradition inspired by him within what one supposes material beings to be securely located. Which is not to say, however, that there is no room in the Freudian tradition for that is Venus being counted as true, even though the term Venus is taken for lack of reference. Andrew Cortens has only recently reminded me afresh that Donald Davidson's paper, Reality Without Reference, undertakes to do just that across the board, in effect retreating from the referential compositionality of the mature Frege to the role of the context principle in his early phase, pretty much by modeling his approach on such Quinean observation sentences as chair, or mountain, or blue, or even rabbit, where only the stimulus meanings of those terms come into play in determining the objective truth conditions of these sentences. Rabbit can thus be true, even if there are no rabbits, for it will suffice to mention but one possibility, at least somewhat congenial to Van Inwagen, if the elementary particles of physics are arranged rabbitishly. The net result of this Davidsonian Quinean approach would appear to promote an ontological anti-realism, and it is not easy to foresee how the sober middle position of material beings might equally avail itself of these resources. My two misgivings regarding the sample thesis of the work, there is no such thing as the planet Venus, both have to do with the compositional semantics involved in the sentence it's phrased pressing. First, there was the issue of the existential quantifier that Quine, at least, has taken to express the refined sense of existence, thereby laying us open to the Wittgensteinian charge of committing the Pickwickian fallacy. Secondly, there has emerged a more narrowly Freudian worry regarding the sense and reference of the proper name Venus. Simply learning the sense of the name surely provides one with a recipe for determining whether it succeeds in denoting. Moreover, astronomers, to look no further, have in fact applied that recipe with the results that are known far and wide, material beings to the contrary notwithstanding, thereby incidentally explaining why the B version of the book detains us not at all. The fact remains that we have seen how, that is Venus, can be true, even if the expression Venus fails to denote anything. It is enough for those particles, I am pointing Venus for, to be materially arranged. So the thrust of material beings is finally confirmed on this key issue. Well, yes, but only at the price of joining Alston and Searle in reverting to the context principle of the early Frege by jettisoning the referential compositionality of the mature doctrine. In going the specific route of Davidson and Quinehoven, it looks as though no so-called singular term can be said to denote, thereby flouting at least one semantic version of metaphysical realism, namely this: some singular terms do succeed in denoting. If a certain novelty attaches to material beings for its heavy reliance on plural referring expressions, one will inevitably have to address their semantics as well, thereby providing us with one more bridge from the ontology proper of the work into theory of meaning. Turning the clock back to the very origins of analytical philosophy in early Frege, our inquiry may also, at the other end, serve to arrest the fairly rapid ascent into oblivion that even Davidson and Quine appear to be undergoing at the moment. One more instance prompting me sometimes to characterize my work as history of philosophy of the species present. If these issues can strike one as dauntingly complex in their interplay of theory of meaning with ontology, I can sum up my principal worry in an abbreviated form by regaling you with the rebuff that I incurred from Frank Jackson, when in my enthusiasm for Hardin's Colorful Philosophers, I rashly assured him that I could prove for him its central thesis in the space of 10 minutes. Most imprudent, you will say. And yet I began promisingly enough in inviting him to accept at the outset the following key premise. Nothing can be just red. It must be some determinate shade of red, pink set, or crimson. More generally, in a logical metaphysical vein, red has been described by W.E. Johnson as a determinable, with pink and crimson being two of its determinants. Would Jackson agree with that thesis regarding color across the board? Yes, he would. There was no hesitation on his part. Gotcha, I almost said aloud, as I proceeded to sketch in Hardin's argument by appealing now to some low-level empirical facts. Take some determinate shade of green. Say for convenience, so-called unique green, which is free from any trace of yellow or blue, though the argument can be shown to apply mutatis mutandis to any other shade. Shown a variety of relevant color samples, you will pick out one as unique green that someone else, whose acuity for green is testably equal to your own, will fault for having in it a detectable trace of yellow. Although mere absence of agreement here, as elsewhere, fails to entail anything substantive on its own, I urge Jackson to concede that broad considerations of reasonableness, hard perhaps to pin down, rendered implausible to the point of absurdity any suggestion that you alone might be tracking reality in the present case. And here also Jackson heartily agreed. So I had won the argument. Not quite. Jackson spoke as follows. I take back what I said before. You have convinced me that something can be red or green or whatever without being any determinate shade of color. And now he urged in the familiar semantic vein that there are community-wide standards that govern the application of color terms like red or green, even though, surprisingly, no such standards apparently obtain when it comes to their determinate shade. Although Jackson can hardly be said to have shown in this encounter, allowing me even to convict him of part in three should I have been so inclined, it was rather I who was sobered by the exchange, doubtless because I knew him to be both an astute philosopher and an honest man. Still more important, perhaps, was my antecedent suspicion that here might well be a Quinean case where some presumptively necessary truth, at once a prioristic and even arguably analytic, namely Johnson's distinction between determinals, determinables, and determinants as regard color predicates, might have to be surrendered in the face of recalcitrant empirical facts, combined with holistic considerations of high theory, in this case considerations in the theory of meaning. Simply as pure ontology, however, I continue to be immensely attracted to the positions of Hardin and Benningwagen alike. The denial of the latter in particular, both Leibniz and Aristotle, Leibniz through his deep connection to Aristotle, could only find highly congenial. Ceasing to practice philosophy in the single-track manner characteristic of the tradition, I find myself increasingly engaged what can only be described as philosophy in the mode of parallel processing. So if I remain primarily involved in the entanglements of traditional ontology, the theory of meaning launched by Frege, I have energy to spare for the renewal of an independent encounter with Aristotle as sponsored by the challenge of material being. Having shown how the history of analytical philosophy itself has grown so top-heavy as to be almost unmanageable, I can only suppose the relevance of history of philosophy in the large, long scorned by analytical philosophers, will once again capture the imaginations of the brightest newcomers into our ranks.
Content of certain motion statements, say the sun moves, is relative to particular situations. It doesn't require that spatial relativism be true or anything like that. But if that's all that's involved, the content relativeness of certain judgments, then why could the example work? We have the sentence, there's a chair in the room, and its content is relative to the particular situation. A bunch of philosophers talking metaphysics and has a certain content. In another situation, it would have a different content. So what exactly is the problem there?
It could be like that. But the difficulty is, we're puzzled by Benningwagen's denial. He tries to reassure us, says it's like the case of Copernicus. And our reaction then is, yes, motion is relative. We understand that. But existence isn't. Now one might try to go on. One might try to go on and explain why existence really is like motion, right, in this respect. But of course he doesn't want to do that.
Well, let's just take his view that the sentence, there's a chair in the next room, can have different content on different occasions of utterance. Now, are you denying that? Are you saying this obviously wrong?
Oh, I am concerned by getting clear about what that metaphysical use is. That's where I bring in the Victor King fallacy. Are we clear about, we understand the ordinary use. Do we understand this other use? And I'm querying whether we do understand.
Philosophers think they do.
Well, that's not so clear after Wittgenstein. This is what I'm bringing out. Philosophers who've read their Wittgenstein Lord, view of all people, Mr. Coggins. I mean, if there was someone in this room who really knew his Wittgenstein, this was absolutely central to the Wittgensteinian. That philosophers misuse language. You're very aware of that.
Well, why not say that there's no misuse of language here. We have the sentence, there is a chair in the next room. And it just so happens that this sentence, given what it means, can express different propositions on different...
It could abstractly, but you also see in this discussion where you could say, I don't understand what this other proposition is supposed to be. It could express it. We might even try to use words to express it, right? It'd be nice if one could turn in his book, let's say, to such a page. Let me express it for you, right? In an awkward way, perhaps, but I'll express the proposition, right? No, that's not done.
Well, we have to think like a good witness, but I'm going to try to speak to you on his behalf.
Just go on.
Okay.
You do understand the Wittgensteinian critique, don't you?
Sure.
Good. There's a very specific critique that Wittgenstein launches against traditional philosophers, doesn't it? It's not as if I'm bringing up it. I'm saying, look, remember Wittgenstein's critique, right? Now, we might even have a reply to that. Fine.
Well, I think we'd hear something from Brené Weyen like this. When I say there's a chair over there, what's the proposition that I express when I say there's a chair in this room? Well, that's just, we understand that perfectly. We don't need philosophers to tell us anything. That's just the proposition that there's a chair in this room.
Good.
All right, now we're talking metaphysics. Brené Weyen says there are no chairs. That entails there are no chairs in this room. What's the proposition we express? Well, it's just the proposition there are no chairs in this room. We understand it perfectly. We're talking metaphysics.
It's as if you haven't read Wittgenstein. We just don't understand. Wittgenstein says we don't understand.
I'm just saying this is how Benel is going to...
I'm talking to you as a student of Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein and people who've studied at Wittgenstein are not going to find a reply like this at all satisfactory. You know that. This is the charge of the Pickwickian fallacy. Remember, let's show how the argument works. Let's remember the image. When you talk about the ordinary sentence, there's no problem about it having meaning. Right? Good. That we know. Wittgenstein claims, however, that we can look at case after case of philosophers' use of language, and that philosophers commit what the English philosophers came to call the Pickwickian fallacy, assigning a supersense to expression and trading in on its ordinary expression. So expressions of this kind that conflict, not anything a philosopher says, it's when a philosopher utters a sentence which conflicts with our ordinary sentence, right? So Wittgenstein here has an elaborate account and actually claims here, we're under an illusion these sentences as used by philosophers have meaning. They do not have meaning. Now I take that to be a very important thesis. Okay?
Well, I understand that. I understand the critique.
Yes.
And so I can understand how Wittgenstein would approach this. That's
yes.
Perfectly sensible.
Yes.
What I meant to point out was merely that it hasn't been shown. I mean, I understand the accusation, but it hasn't been shown that the accusation is here justified.
I mean, here I present you with, I present a whole body of work on this particular thing. You can go in and review it if you want us to do it. It hasn't been justified. There it is. What is your objection to the Wittgensteinian critique here? It hasn't been justified. Explain why not. There's a huge body of work there. Why do you feel that it hasn't been justified? I'm not going to do anything beyond. I mean, you're asking me as a word to say, but do give us more. Tell me why, by the way, you don't think what he had to say on this is justified.
Well, we have other examples where philosophers appear to contradict what people are saying.
Like words like, well, no, for example. Wait, okay, how about this one?
we don't know that there's a change. How's that work? How about the philosophers, the skeptics, who say we don't know there's a change? Is there something about that? Well, can we use that as an example?
No.
Would you allow me to use that as an example? You said there are cases where philosophers are good. Now!
I think you're in trouble.
Well, then what? I mean, obviously, you know, in these debates, one chooses the examples that's favorable. I'm not exactly here being impartial. You know that. Other examples, well, you might be in trouble. But let's take this one. Let's take this one. This is an example, just as a fact, where analytic philosophy since Wittgenstein has gone completely along with him on this particular example. Namely, that in order to defend skepticism, think of the struggles of someone like Peter Unger as he tries to cope on this particular point. Contemporary epistemology absolutely swallowed that. Therefore, to make the skeptical case that we don't know there's a chain is a very difficult, tricky thing. That's why it's almost impossible to find any skeptics, except someone like Peter Unger, who had to fight a valiant fight to be at all listened to. What I'm trying to bring out is, let's use this as an example, right? Now the point is, this is on this particular example, the Wittgensteinians absolutely won. Now maybe you can find another example. Why not? That would be a very nice reply, but I'll accept that as a reply. Namely, show me other examples where we can say, unlike the no case, right? Then I'll have to say, okay, back to the drawing board for me.
What about the passage in Material Beings where, suppose as a philosopher, I deny there are pains, and then I deny there are pains, and then one day I say I have this pain in my shoulder. Someone says, aha, you say there are no pains, but you've just contradicted yourself because you say there's a pain in your left shoulder. And I say, well, the proposition that I express, or the thesis there are no pains, is consistent with the proposition I express. I say there's a pain in my left shoulder.
Okay, that's a good example.
Okay. Well, the proposition that I express, I say there are no chairs, is consistent with the proposition that an ordinary man might express when he says there's a chair in the next room.
Okay, that's a good case. I can see that that's a good example. And counts against me.
So it's not automatic.
Well, no. I'm going on. The next thing we might try to do, however, is try to state what that proposition is, right? In, say, ordinary language. One of the embarrassing things we might find, is what I'm suggesting, is that when we take this statement, there are no chairs, and try to state it, let's say, in a completely perspicuous way, we may come up, indeed, with a statement which is completely unobjectionable from any point of view, but will then lose its cutting edge. You do follow the possibility. So it's not that. It's not that. Notice the point. It's not that you could then come up with some statement. It's not as if there's any doubt here that you could come up with a proposition, which might be a very plausible proposition. But I accept you, by the way, as a good case. Let me point out, however, let me say the following. Let's even pursue this. Why is it that philosophers, for example, are attracted to your case? Let's talk about, say, philosophy of language. See, they look at the case, there are no pains, there are no pains. And the standard view goes like this, you know. There is a central core of our language which provides us with our central paradigm. So if I say there's a chair in the next room, that's the real thing. If I say there's a pain in my foot, which by the way is a funny case anyway, there's a pain in my foot. Notice it doesn't matter whether you're a materialist or a dualist, right? Now wait, oh, good, now we're tracking. Now, there's a pain in my foot. We say things like that. Now that looks utterly mystifying to philosophers. You see that?
whether you're a materialist or a dualist or anything.
Right.
Okay. Now, why is that? It then turns out that philosophers look at statements like there's a pain in our foot, and they say that in our language, the fundamental kind of statements, the core statements, are statements like there's a chair in that room. Whereas statements like there's a pain in my foot are then funny kinds of cases. And that's why in these funny cases, going back to Ryle's paper on systematically misleading statement cases. Okay. So we then tell a story, and the philosopher of all people can see that. It's a pain in my foot. You know, all the philosophical views, you see, look at that and say, you know, can you really mean that there's a pain in the foot? Right. Okay. And the easy way out is to say that we have a sentence of the form, there is an F in a G, and that the unproblematic cases are, there is an apple in that basket, and that you're assimilating it to the case of the pain in the foot. Right? Good. So we're able to handle the pain case, or the pain in the foot, as being sort of the funny business about language, as opposed to there's an apple in the basket. And we've all been taught to believe that here we've hit something unproblematical. In this case, the logical form of the statement is absolutely on its surface. So what's disturbing in what Dynamic is doing is that he comes along and now, as it were, takes statements like there's an apple in the basket and tries then, as it were, to do the kind of monkey business that, of course, as professionals, we're all acquainted with statements like there's a pain in the foot. But the way we were able to play our game of monkey business as regards the pain in the foot is by contrast with the apple in the basket. You see that? So if someone now comes along and tells us that there's sort of something funny going on in the sentence, there's an apple in the basket, see, now that the rules of the game are being changed now, we really don't know how to operate. And, let's see.
My thinking about the philosophy of language has certainly been deeply influenced by uncertainty. And in fact, I expect that influence is at the root of my the distinction between what you call the A and the B versions, and probably the reason I favor the A version. And it's for that reason, the reason that I favor the A version, as you say, I provide the optional B version, that I am at such pains to explain one proposition as that's expressed in the philosophy by there are no chairs. And it is the proposition that well, there are no chairs in the next room. That is, of all the chair receptacles in the next room, there is no physical object that exactly fills any of them, or of all the things that may be inside any given chair receptacle in the next room, it's never the case that all those things have a very logical self. But of course, if there were any things bigger than elementary particles that were alive, that would be false.
But now, the difficulty with that is that you take the A version and you say the ordinary sentence is a true sentence.
And it expresses
a true proposition.
One that's consistent with that.
Right. Well, that's the problem. It doesn't look obvious. It looks as if it's inconsistent. Namely, it looks as if here, if I say there's a chair in the room, that's an unproblematic case. Now you tell me that
well, let's suppose I grant you that it doesn't look as if it's inconsistent. So why? Looks as if the sun goes around the earth.
Oh, that's why I try to say there's an important difference in the two cases.
Well, I only meant that there's a sign, there's a theory, there's something that appears to us to be the case. It looks as if this stick in the corner is bending straight. Lots of things appear to be the case when they are. Your initial reaction is to say that it looks as if those two are in fact inconsistent, or I say they're consistent. But of course, theoretical concerns might militate.
They might do that. Then I suggest here this is where philosophy of language must come in.
No, I think this is where metaphysics must come in. We must have a theory of composition to see which would tell us whether we can in fact generate objects to fill up those regions if we can't come up with a coherent theory.
I want to say theory of meaning is crucial here. You say the statement there's a chair in this room. You're saying the ordinary sense. Here's the point. The normal, the standard way philosophers have thought about language, and this could be wrong, we could re-examine it, is that there are funny business sentences, like this paper by foot. And then there are the sentences which, as it were, their logical form is on the surface. And there's a whole body of work, mainstream philosophy of language, that then takes ordinary material object sentences being the ones that have on their surface their logical form. Now that's the standard.
I agree with some unreflected people say that.
Oh, I see, you're questioning that now.
I'm questioning that as a data, which sentence, maybe there are
I don't accept this, as I'm not claiming this is sort of a truth. What I'm claiming, though, is that in...
I'll grant you that there are some sentences that have their logical form. On the surface, what I'm rejecting the idea is a data which one they are. It has to be said by your
own. Well, one of the except that I say this is, look, you yourself say in your book you're not going to do philosophy of language. My criticism here is that within the mainstream philosophy of language, as it's done, it's very mystifying where you're coming from.
So much the worse for the mainstream philosophy.
Well, no.
which takes physical object sentences, or these sentences about medium-sized bits of dry goods around us, as wearing their logical forms on their sleeves.
Okay, now let's get this. You're writing a book. There is the dominant philosophy of language today, which is myth and has this character. If your book is right, then this central thesis of the dominant philosophy of language is mistaken.
No. They can always be beasts.
Be what?
They
can always. Right, but I'm assuming also that's out.
Well, look, what do you think I presented this option for? I want to talk about metaphysics, not about philosophy of language. I'm saying, look, if you here's my philosophy of language, but if you reject it, you can always take this other philosophy of language, and I'm interested in arguing about metaphysics.
Ah! Yeah, but look, already you can see the form of it. Let's put it this way. You do agree, then, that when it comes to the philosophy of language part, that's an independent inquiry, that we might come to the conclusion that the right way goes the A way.
Yes.
Okay. And I'm assuming, then, that in fact, in terms of what most people do with philosophy of language today, that is the way they would like to go. They would consider going the B way. So, on the philosophy of language side, they're going the A way. And the trouble they have, that going the A way, they find that they can't combine that with their view. They not only want to go the A way, but they also want to say, like, statements like there's a chair in the next room, carry their logical form on their surface. That is the dominant approach. Good. So what you're saying now becomes intriguingly peculiar, you see. And all I'm urging at this point, then, is what's occurring at this point, from the standpoint of dominant philosophy of language, what the person has to say to himself is, well, maybe Van Inwagen could enter into philosophy of language and show us how various things he wants to do. But of course, he hasn't done that. Now, we, therefore, within...
They can say if they want these sentences wear their logical forms on their sleeves and that this is the logical form, but if they also want to say that those sentences express truths, then certain objects actually have to exist to be arranged in certain ways for those sentences to come out true. Now, how the bloody hell did they find out that their objects exist? So by some sort of metaphysical intuition?
No. Now we could go, not for the next stage, the next stage would be to go, say, the B route. You say that's in a way what you're inviting here.
But what I'm trying to bring out is extremely frustrating, is that you have a certain metaphysics here. You have not actually made Hegel stand in philosophy, well, express your own attitude, but you haven't made philosophic moves in the philosophy of language. And so the picture then gets as follows. Yes, the easiest way for us to understand this and accept what he's saying would be to go to the people. However, this is what people in philosophy of language would say, within all the work we have been doing in philosophy of language, the A root is the right movement, unless someone can come along and boost the B root.
Well, I think that philosophers of language tend to be metaphysically extremely naive. That is, they tend unconsciously to believe that there are the objects available that will make out, they pick up a logical form for a sentence. I'll give you a perfect example of this. Bernie Lepore said, well, of course there are four-dimensional objects because that's what we need in philosophy of language in order to make certain sentences about time have a about endurance through time have a simple logical form that we want them to have. And it turned out that I pointed out to a parallel argument would make him believe that there's something like the way you look from the front, say, because, gosh, the example isn't so good because I can't remember the details. I wish I had my mind. But anyway, it turned out that actually parallel arguments about adverbial sentences would commit him to all sorts of crazy things he didn't want. But he never thought about that. That's what he said, gee, I never thought about that.
Not good.
and he is one of our more metaphysical
cute. Let me sum it up this way. The way I see the case is this: there's a big lacuna which is deliberately left. It's not a lacuna which, in the sense, could be. Let's say someone is looking at your book sympathetically. Think of it this way: think of a philosopher today involved in philosophy of language, also metaphysical, who's even sympathetic to what you're doing metaphysically. I think it's going to be felt to be quite frustrating. It doesn't seem easy to see how to proceed on the philosophy of language front. It's not as if that was sort of a routine task. Gee, I'd like to sort of go with that. You know, really stir things up in philosophy of language. And then the question is, how does one do that? It's not so easy to do. See, that you haven't provided pointers here as to how that could be done.
I'll talk about it. Well, it's easy enough. If you have a genuine, a sort of general Freudian, Tarskian, constructivist philosophy of language, and you say that this ordinary sentence has this logical form, and then, of course, this logical form will only be true, then we can read off that only if there are certain objects arranged in certain ways and make certain intrinsic properties, then you owe us an account of what these objects are like, which means and every object that actually exists for every property must either have that property or its complement. So you're going to have to give us some kind of picture of what properties these objects have. And most philosophers of language have not even bothered to try to give a coherent account of the properties possessed by the objects that they pick. They pick out objects functionally, and then they don't worry about the ontology, whether there is any kind of logically coherent theory of these objects that would actually answer to the functional description of the object that they need to make the relevant sentences come out true. That's my guideline. Think about metaphysics if you insist on doing philosophy of language in that mode, which of course is not the only mode for doing philosophy of language. It's not what Wittgenstein did, for example.
Well, I think that the standard response would be, yes, that is the more sensitive of your critics here, you know, would say, you're pointing to a vulnerability of ours. We acknowledge that, but whereas you're so pessimistic about what can be done here, they would find that very, very plausible. What you've done here, the issue really comes to this. Does your metaphysics stand on its own apart? apart from philosophy of language. Zoom in.
I don't see.
Oh,
really? Maybe I don't know what you mean by that. But why should you expand it? I mean, maybe nothing can stand apart from philosophy of language, but I think it can as much as anything possibly could, as much as any piece of philosophy of ethics or political philosophy.
Well, I mean in this way. Supposing the dominant philosophy of language, which it has the following doctrines, that the sentence that is said, we know various ways in which it can be formed, right? We grasp the truth conditions of the sentence. There's a chain.
You mean Tarskian style truth conditions? Or Wittgensteinian, it looks this way, conditions?
See, this is where theory of meaning comes in. Again. I mean, the notion of there's a chair here, according to the dominant view, is very hard to coordinate with your type of propositions of this kind, say, the particles here constitute an object. And what makes that difficult is, on the one hand, we have the ordinary sentence, which is going to be, as it were, somehow a real meaning. You would agree with that, that you would not sort of despise it, or so you have that common ground here, in a sense. Right, no, that's important, because there'd be other philosophers who would. You'd go along with this here, and the picture that you have, and this is again the A reading, because it so hasn't been filled out in philosophy of language terms, which is that ordinary people are making true statements when they say there's a chair. See, I pointed out, one of the things I pointed out is that the way mainstream philosophy of language has gone is this. It has taken statements like there's a pain in my foot as being sort of deviant and peculiar, and that paradigm statements are statements like there's an apple in the basket. So, mainstream philosophy of language has felt that we understand our workings of our language clearly enough to see that when we want to look for the meanings of such expressions as there is and there are, statements like there's a pain in my foot, those are peculiar. There's an apple in the basket. That's where these the basic meanings of these words show themselves. Now that is
what word?
Expression like this.
Yes. Well, I take it that they do.
Okay, now, so we have there's an apple in this basket. And then the view would be this expression. This is you couldn't get any clearer about this. And you want to say that it's a true proposition expressed, but when it comes to expressing what that proposition is, even at one point you do say, were you willing to use the word there's an apple in the basket to express that proposition? Well, what is the proposition expressed when you say there's an apple in the basket? Well, there's just an apple in the basket. Okay. Then we come to your metaphysics, however, and we read your metaphysics, and I don't know if apples are a very good case, I suppose not, but there's a stone in the then we come at your metaphysics, and you come and tell us there are no stones. And you don't mean this in any fancy way, as if this were sort of a shorthand for some kind of, elaborate statement. No, you don't write out, well, I believe there are no stones. I also believe that the ordinary man, when he says that there's a stone in the basket, is saying something true. Now, it really is the case here, that according to mainstream philosophy of language, this is the clearest instance of the existential quantifier we could possibly have.
Well, and I therefore, agree that the existential quantifier means whatever it does anywhere else, and then it's got a different meaning.
Right, okay. You want, however, a different proposition to be expressed by you. All right, again,
you've got the word stone being used in its ordinary sense. There are in basket all being used in ordinary sense. ordinary sense. It just that ordinary sentences aren't combinatorial. That is just semantically combinatorial. That only happens in very carefully constructed languages. The situation takes the meanings of those things and determines the situation of the proposition they express. And it might give them another proposition to express in different circumstances. So the information that determines what proposition expressed is both part of the whole situation and the individual meanings of the terms. But I take it they already do have their ordinary meanings in that sense.
You know, why you're charging Benning, Wagon with sort of kicking out from under himself. Mainstream philosophy of language, in the sense that he's using it, but taking away the central cases. Could you say a bit about how, say, Bennett Spinoza goes on the same line? Is it even more radical than Van Inwagen's in? In taking away from itself the ability to use mainstream philosophy of language.
Let's take Benedict Spinoza. Okay. Supposing we were to take it as, it's a brilliant contemporary rendition.
Right.
Sure. But supposing we were to take it sort of really seriously philosophically.
Right.
And remember that I was so grateful for any kind of light on Spinoza, you see, that we've sort of enraptured that we've gone as far as we have. Now, it's only because of that I realize sort of my enthusiasm for Bennett on Spinoza. I feel that I understand things and so on. But now that you pose this point, then the question still would be, Spinoza now has the ontology, there's only one. We would really be faced, right? We've been enjoying Bennett's account so much and so on, simply because by contrast, we're really going to be grateful for almost anything, right? But if you really want to get down to business now, right, we are going to be faced with this kind of question, namely that we make these ordinary statements, there's a chair in the next room, right? And according to dominant philosophy of language, those are sentences which bear their logical form on their surface, right? I mean, we're prepared to change our minds about it. I mean, this is, you know, it's that we, this is where we're starting from, a huge right. body of work that says, these are sentences that can be taken at face value, right? And remember why we're disturbed about it, because remember, the whole philosophy of language then takes certain sentences as paradigmatic. And one thing we're surely right about, and that is, if the paradigms aren't going to be found here, where are they going to be found? Let me show you, now in a way, Van Inwagen does something like that. He will have statements like, there's a cat in the next room. Those statements will, in this case, their obvious logical form.
Don't forget about the room.
Yeah. The room's a problem, right? Okay. Notice just from a philosophy of language standpoint how implausible that looks. Let's say someone is really sympathetic to Van Inwagen on the metaphysical side, right? And shifts from the metaphysical question to the philosophy of language side. It would really have to be then this, that when we say there's a stone in the room, that really has a different logical form than there's a cat in the room. But even, you see, now, even if one is sympathetic to him, to the ontology, there are cats but no stones, great. That looks very, that doesn't look right to people working in full. It just doesn't look right, right? So again, when you pose that exact question, in the case of Bennett's reconstruction of Spinoza, if we were to really treat it as a contribution to contemporary philosophy today, we would really have to say to Bennett, now look here, you have an account of which there's only, it looks as if there's only, there exist. It looks as if you have, there exists an X, such that for any Y, Y is identical with X, right? There's only one, yeah. And we would then have to say to Bennett, what do you do with philosophy of language today, which treats all these sentences and treats them as having that the surface grammar reveals the underlying logical form. We would need a lot of guidance, you see. So I'm saying, even if one's very sympathetic on the metaphysical side, you see, if one's sympathetic on the metaphysical side, supposing one was very sympathetic on the metaphysical side, said, gee, I'd like to get into the, you know, I'm going to really cause trouble for these philosophers of language, right? An ambitious graduate student. It's not going to be such easy going.
I'm not familiar with that much of language that's made after Quine, and I'm not familiar with and I'm not sure how much your argument is related to something that might be based on Aristotle or something like that.
I'm a soft touch. I'm a pushover.
I'm very much interested in Aristotle. You've repeatedly emphasized this problem in the stream of language, that the statement, the meat and potatoes of modern philosophy of language, the statements conform, the apple is in the basket, the paint in the front is a problem that I understand the problem, because I'm so on. I see another stream of creative language that's also modern, that harkens back to Aristotle in some sense, I think, and that's the phenomenological tradition, which was converted that paradox to say that the apple in the basket is the secondary derivative precisely because it has this first person proposition in it, namely the relationship of English is not a relation that holds in a neutral third person description of space, but is related to certain orientation with respect to your saying that the apple in the basket is true. If it is true, in fact, you're probably in an upright position in the room and you're hanging from the ceiling, it might be true to say that the apple is under the basket. And on the other hand, statements like the pain is in my foot are going to be true to you in any type of orientation. In fact, structures like that that allow you to identify sensations inside your body are kind of prior to your ability to relate to external configurations of objects. So your emphasis on this problem seems to me, because of my interest, to be a strange one. There seem to be these other approaches that would take up language in a certain way, which is going to convert that problem, and perhaps provide an address of that coincide with the
when you use the word phenomenological approach, by the way, being here, in this setting,
in the account of language that I gave, I was thinking more about Ponti. And his account of language is very broad.
And he takes then, there's a pain in my foot, it's more fundamental.
I think.
Really?
In what it, yes. I would say that in his account, first of all, that the utterance. An apple in the basket would be construed as a gesture that has to do with my particular lived experience of the world in a particular situation, which in some way forms up the fact that for me in this world there is an apple in the basket. And a better example would be something of the Kantian description of walking through the house or taking off the house as being a construct of different views on the particular space where one motifs particulars. And it says that what's implicit in Kant's argument, what he is bringing out, is that there is an embodied observer in this building from these positions, that is the movement of this observer through these positions that allows for this particular synthesis of different perceptions to take place. So implicit behind every statement describes the relations between external and support, and there is an external. There is it's implicit that there is a positional located, oriented view onto things. And this was again in something with an intentional dimension to it. There's a value in that the side of the guy opposite also has an unprotected view.
Journal is constantly destroying Descartes.
Right. Okay, now, and Husserl is sympathetic to that.
Phenomenology is not going to be psychologistic and subjectivist, right?
So I would then say that it included then, so you take the case of Husserl, and I would have to look into Merleau-Ponty.
Once that issue of subjectivity and objectivity came up, right?
Namely, an analytic philosophy. Analytic tradition,
grave suspicions about subjectivity. Grave suspicions concerning the primacy of the subjective point of view of Descartes. Right? So that just saturates
everything. Well, for Merleau-Ponty, the whole object of this philosophy is to say that the division between subject and object is completely here.
Okay, well, he's all around.
But notice, he says that it's incoherent distinction. Then sort of the statement is a pain in my foot will also, in a way, lose its Cartesian cachet. That is, in the Cartesian tradition, there's a pain in my foot, at least has a certain claim here. And what's coming out basically is that kind of tradition I'm talking about, which I think includes Husserl also, and probably Merleau-Ponty also because of breaking down that barrier, is a refusal to get sucked into Cartesian subjectivism. And that is the major imperative, you might say, in 20th century philosophy, just like everyone. In the sense that you don't follow this imperative, then you're just going to be on the path. You know, it's all right. But, so the claim, it's just that you're not breaking new ground. To break new ground is then to resist Cartesian subjectivism. So the claim, it's just that that's so massive in so many movements of philosophy that I suspect, even as you mentioned Merleau-Ponty, that's what's underlying.
What about the issue of embodiment?
Oh, again, again, the Cartesian tradition, somehow we can clearly understand ourselves as disembodied. The tradition I'm talking about. So all the interesting things in 20th century philosophy are precisely saying that's the way it looks from a Cartesian book, you begin up to swallow it. I don't know if that answers what you were sort of concerned about. Does that sort of help? I mean, does that at least help about some direction here? Namely, I'm working in a context which is not just unreal. That's what I'm trying to extend. So much of 20th century philosophy, and it's almost tautological to say, that so much that anything groundbreaking in 20th century philosophy is going to then approach subjectivity. Otherwise, it's not going to be groundbreaking. Really, really trivial. Because so much of it goes in that direction, I am presupposing a general
closely.
You say to Searle, that you just quoted a passage in which he says, the property of saintliness is something none of us possess. It's just a fancy way of saying none of us are saints. And then you put to him the challenge of, well, what about apes? Some shapes are uninstantiated. And the challenge, of course, is, well, it's just a fancy way of saying, well, what? You go on, another quote from Searle. I can countenance or refuse to countenance rude behavior by my children, but how do I go about countenancing numbers or classes? End of quote. Well, Searle has shown us precisely how when he insists that talk about the property of saintliness is just a fancy way of saying something that on the face of it is acceptable to the nominalist. Denying that proposition, denying that it is just a fancy way of saying something acceptable to the nominalist, is how one goes about countenancing the property of saintliness in the ontology game. I was trying to think of how Searle might respond. And one thing I thought he might say is, well, gosh, if that's all you mean by countenancing a type of entity, well, fine, I guess we can describe it that way. And I suppose, well, look, let's look at eight. Some shapes are uninstantiated. Maybe there just is no other way of saying that. Maybe the fact expressed by eight is a fact that there's pretty much only one way of expressing it. Whereas in the case of saintliness, the saintliness sentence, there's other ways of expressing it there, except for the ones. But why on that account do you want to say that one involves asserting the existence of something and the other doesn't? After all, it's you Quinians who insist on the univocality of there is from one situation to the next. Well, I think there is, as it figures in eight, actually eight has some shapes. Well, there is a shape that's unestablished with some. I think there is, as it figures in eight, is the same kind of, has the same sense as there is, as it figures in, nine, there is a possibility that James will come. In spite of the fact that nine, there happens to be another way of saying it. Eight, there isn't. So, how would you respond to that attempt to preserve kind of the basic thrust of his position of examples?
I'd say that he sort of laid down the rules himself. He wants to change the rules, he can, and then I don't know what I'd say. But the way he put it was, all this fuss over the question of saintliness. This is just a fancy way of saying such and such. This is the way he does it. Namely, there are then nominalists, that there are Platonists and nominalists who argue over the question whether they're saintliness. Right? And then he says, look, what's the big fuss? Surely nominalists and Platonists should be able to agree, because after all, when we talk about, we say, make this remark about saintliness, that's just a fancy way of doing such and such. It looks as if he's laid the rules of the game down, as if he said, he comes and he says, whenever it comes to the ontological status of something, that therefore there isn't any real issue if it's just a fancy way of doing such and such. He's laid down the rules. And then I come and say, I'll play by your game. I'll play by your rules. So I admit it's very unhominem when I'm saying, look, I'm going to play by your rules. Right? It looks as if you've laid down rules which would suggest the following. That in the saintliness case, if we couldn't find a way of saying the same thing, then that really would be a serious matter. I mean, isn't that the way he has set the thing up? I admit, you might call it a cheap trick, but the point is, this is where a philosopher sets up the thing. And this is the way, at least, we can argue with one another. And he's laid down certain rules, and I'm saying, great, I'll accept your rules. That gives me a chance to be able to make a point. Now you may be going on to another point, and maybe I can't answer that point, right? I mean, that would be a further, but at least, maybe in the debate then, if you want to treat that as another point that you're making. But I go back and I say, I just do one thing. Searle has laid down the rules of the game. He has said, what's the fuss about saying things?
it's just the fancy way of saying such and such. And then I come and say, I'll play by your rules. Whatever we have, a putative abstract entity, and we can show that it's just a fancy way of saying such and such, then it doesn't matter whether you're for or against it, and there's no real issue. I say, I'll go along with that. Then I say to Searle, but the way you've even laid the rules of the game on, you are inviting me to give you a case in which you can't say it's just a fancy way of saying, right? You've laid down those rules, I give you this case.
Okay, well, suppose Searle doesn't say what I just said, but another philosopher, Searle Prime, says what I just said. is the position of Searle Prime, in fact, maybe one of the positions that your work in this paper might even suggest?
Well, I've already suggested the reply to this is given by Dummett. That is, we have then a realist account of reference and an anti-realist account of reference. I actually quote Dummett on that. That's precisely what Dummett, in his book, new book, makes the move. Namely, if you have an expression like the number of f's, which then really has no independent sense and reference of its own, that will count as a case where we can admit the number of f's, but that will be an anti-realist acceptance of the number of f's. We'll distinguish that from a realist account where we have a referring expression which actually contributes a sense of reference. So the idea is to be able to then say, in some tolerant way, both of these expressions refer, but we can really make an important distinction. Namely, that there'll be expressions like the number of F's, or saintliness, or whatever, which really do not, where the sense and reference of the expression seem to be irrelevant to the truth value of the sentence. There'll be other expressions where you will have a definite description, where indeed you can show that the expression brings to the sentence an antecedent sense and reference of its own. And then the claim is, just look, isn't this a major distinction between two types of expression? And doesn't this correspond, really, to our intuitions all along? We've been talking about realism and anti-realism.